sand in a bus, and there were a load of astronauts who were having a heck of a time trying to push that bus out of the sand. Do you remember that?
I will remember that, and of course, Prince Sultan and the camels, and yes, and oh yes, but my most vivid memory is trying to dance on sand with my partner, Alexei Leonov.
Ah, yes, Alexei. Well, it's a great pleasure to hear your voice, and you are as sharp as ever. Best of good wishes to you, Arthur. I'm going to pass it back to Fred Ordway.
Okay, Arthur, we're going to say good night and good morning to you. Since you talked about that little adventure in Saudi Arabia, the last time we got together personally was in Beijing, China. But that has nothing to do with anything. I'll tell you a story from my grandmother's favorite stories about travel. She was brought up in Maine in many, many years ago, and she used to tell me a story about the stagecoaches in her very, very youthful years. If they got into a mud pit, the driver would say, first-class passengers, get up and keep your seats. Second-class passengers, get out and walk. And third-class passengers, get out and push. My grandmother's favorite story, Arthur. I think this is it tonight.
We have one more. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. We have another very, very visitor for you.
Hello, Arthur. This is Brian Edwards. It's nice to talk to you. I guess I'm one of them who hasn't mentioned yet. But I guess at the moment I do feel a connection with you since I'm working on one of your ideas.
For the space innovator?
Yes.
Yes, I think that's going to be the key to space travel, but not in our time.
I'm hoping to at least get a little closer, but I do thank you for your input and your discussions, and if you feel up to it, you're more than welcome to help with it.
Well, I won't be leaving Sri Lanka again. It's too much of a hassle, even to get to the airport. And recently I had a half-series invitation from Mirror Corps to go up on one of their flights, but I don't think I'll ever make it. Good luck.
Arthur, this is Bob Freeman, the conference chairman again.
Uh-huh.
And we really appreciate you making this call for us today and also making that fantastic videotape that that you made for us. We're going to show that a little later in the program tonight.
Okay, well, good luck, and I wish I could be there, but I feel I'm there in spirit.
Oh, yes, well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
where is it and why isn't it shown in theaters? Flying down from Boston a few weeks ago, I looked at the Delta Sky magazine, and they had a nice little piece called, headline, "Hey, Warner Brothers, it's 2001. And then the subtitle, "Is there intelligent life in Hollywood?" Slides to give you some background also, and I'm going to show a film that was made at Borrowwood in the MGM British Studios back in late 65 into 1966, including the section with Arthur Clarke being interviewed inside the lunar module mock-up at the Grumman Aircraft Corporation in New York. Kubrick had completed Dr. Strangelove, shown in 1964. He became interested very, very quickly thereafter in space. The reasons were very simple. As we all learned in various sessions today, the first Russian went up, the first American went up back in 61 and the 25th of May. President Kennedy gave his famous address calling for expeditions to the moon by the end of the decade. We all know about Tito. We all know about Gagarin, John Glenn's flights. The Mercury's went on from 62 to 63. The first Mariner probe, the first interplanetary probe was an American probe that went by Venus back in 1962. We had the Mariner 4 go by Mars in 64. Space was on everybody's mind, and Kubrick had made up his mind that he was going to do a first-rate, big-budget film dealing with the space program. Most particularly the concept of extraterrestrial intelligence. Through an intermediary, Roger Karras, he contacted Clark. He had read everything he could lay his hands on, both fiction and nonfiction, seen clips or portions of all, many, many movies going back to Things to Come back in 1930, and he was particularly impressed with Forbidden Planet in 1956, with Walking with Pigeon and Anne Francis. I think it's one of the few big budget film, and of course Destination Moon and others. He was attracted by Arthur Clarke's story, The Sentinel. Sentinel was written back in 1948 as a contest piece for a BBC radio, a contest, BBC radio. And people had, the question was, prepare some short stories and see who wins the prize. The Sentinel didn't win. It was subsequently in 1951 published as a short story in the British Fantasy and Science Fiction magazine, and has been appeared in anthologies ever since. And it was in the anthologies that that particular story attracted Kubrick's attention. It wasn't a slab underground. It was a pyramid on a high plateau, or a corridor plateau on the lunar surface. That led to Kubrick to contact Clark in early 1964. In April of that year, Clark happened to be in town, or was in town, doing two things. One, the opening of the New York School's Fair, and secondly, he was involved with a book, a Man in Space book, with the editors of Life, a Time Life book. So he was in New York. They met in April at Trader Vic's at the Plaza Hotel, and that was their first contact with one another. What led from there was finally a contract was signed with which Clark was paid a sum of money for the rights for The Sentinel and about a half a dozen other of his short stories. But The Sentinel was still the key element that Hoover was interested in. I came aboard the film in January of 1965. The reason for that was just totally unplanned. I happened to be in New York at a meeting of the American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics, and also meeting with some publishers. Somebody during the course of the day said, "Hey, by the way, Fred, your old friend Arthur Clarke was in town." I'd known Arthur going back to 1950, believe it or not, and I got to know him well in the early 1950s. And I knew where he stayed, the Chelsea Hotel. I called He was have to be in. If he wasn't in, this would never happen, as far as I'm concerned. He answered the phone, and we set up a get-together for cocktails later in the afternoon. And he told me what he was doing, and I told him, well, that's strange, Arthur. You know, I'm up here with an associate of mine, Harry Longy. We were all from Huntsville, Alabama, by the way. We worked for NASA at Marshall Space Flight Center. And we were doing some books. One was called Intelligence in the Universe, which was published by a year later by Brennan Hall, and a shorter book, Life in Other Solar Systems, published by Dutton. And he said, oh my God, he said, I'm working with Stanley Cooper on the same theme. Anyway, we looked at our watches. It was getting late. We both had separate dinner engagements. So we said goodbye until the next time. I went up to get my coat, came down to the front door from the club I was staying at, and just as I was ready to go out front to hail a cab to go to the dinner, one of the employees said, there's a call for me. And I went back to one of the little cabins and picked up the phone, and the voice said, my name is Stanley Cooper. So, Stanley Cooper, well, of course I knew who he was, and I knew more so, having just talked to Arthur Clark. But that led to a meeting the next day, and one thing led to another, and I joined the project and worked on the project for a good couple of years. But when I came aboard in January, Cooper did not have a contract. He was working with MGM, but it wasn't until late February that MGM actually agreed to make the film. O'Brien, the president of MGM, made the announcement in late February, and he authorized $6.5 million to make the film. And he further said it would be shot in Super Panavision, 70 millimeter with 5mm, that was dedicated to stereo soundtrack, and that it would be in the Cinerama format. So we were moving ahead very quickly. I have a few other notes just to tell you. We all worked in New York at Central Park West until the summer of 1965 when our group moved to England. We set up shop at the MGM British Studios in Boreham Wood. The actual live filming didn't start until late December of 1965. In fact, the tail end of December, 29th of December, we shot at the Shepperton Studios. We did the type of magnetic anomaly one site there, which required a huge pit, if you all know and seen the film. But that was the largest studio accessible to us in England. We shot there for 4 or 5 or 6 days, and then moved over to the MGM studios and started filming there on the 6th of January, 1966. That's when filming started at MGM. And I'm going to show you a few slides. Can we see the slides and lower the lights? And then I'm going to show a film which we made back in 1966, showing how things were, how we all appeared here, and myself and others, and Arthur Clark and Stanley Kubrick, and others, how we were in 1965.
Okay, here's where we made the film. These are the MGM studios in
Boreham
Wood.
Sorry, is it on? I'm sorry. These are the MGM British studios, just north of London. Next slide, please. That's where we all began to work in the summer of 1965. I had daily conferences with Stanley Kubrick on all of the technical aspects of the film. I was involved in all the various vehicular architecture, the modules, and all the elements that you see in the portion beginning with Orion 1, Orion 3, the first shots, all the way to the arrival of the Discovery spaceship to the planet Jupiter. Next, please. We were the subject of just unending business. A film that attracted an enormous amount of interest. We had George Miller, who ran the manned space flight program during the Apollo years there, Deke Slayton and many others. In fact, they called us NASA East. We had so much documentation from NASA and from corporations and from universities. This particular picture I show here, you can see Stanley Kubrick on the right, Arthur Clark, myself. The other people, we had some Russian science attachés there, and we were very interested, and they were very helpful in getting some of the Luna 9 surface photography. We used Marilyn Rainford 7 photography, but we wanted the down to the earth ground stuff for our film. So they cooperated very, very nicely. Next. A bit of trivia. This was class. have your space. This was a piece that was deleted when Cooper began to shorten the film. A nice little set which showed Hayward Floyd on the way to a briefing, stopping by to see a standard idea of a scene on the moon from an art class. Cooper's $2 over the left, Anya and Vivian, getting art lessons to give the idea that it was totally a home-like environment. The families were there, kids were there, wives were there, and so forth. That was cut. Next. And so the only thing we saw on Clavius base on the moon was the briefing. And in this room, Edward Floyd gets a briefing and then gives the a short talk himself. Next. This is the famous spaceship Discovery. Next, please. I wanted just to show you all, that before you see the film, what the configuration of Discovery as we visualized it back in those days. You can see the centrifuge, the pod bay area with the three extra vehicular activity vehicles were. We call them pods. The command module, the HAL area. Next, we'll take a look at that in a little different perspective. Scene where HAL, the computer, HAL Logic Center, the pod bay in the lower part, the airlock where Keir Dullea made his famous entry, of the spare parts area where he took out the spare unit, 137 unit. Next, please. So that gives you a feeling as to what it all looked like. This is the scene, which I think Keir is going to talk about a little later, of the moving from the core to the centrifuge. Next. The centrifuge was only, in this case, only real 40 feet in diameter. The real world wouldn't have been that low. Coriolis forces were, of course, vertical to the crew, but we were constrained by the diameter of the stage at the MGM British Studios. But we went to a great deal of effort to develop all the different modules, and each module was done with exquisite care and with the advice and counsel of many experts in many fields. Next. Just to show you some of the elements that we had in that centrifuge, you can see what they all were. Hibernation, of course, was a key one. The pressure room was really what we today call a storm center in the event of high solar fluxes, solar flare eruption. The crew would have gone in there during that period. Next. Hibernation. Three of the crew were in hibernation. Next. We went to a great deal of work also on to make that system as realistic as possible by consulting with top workers in hibernation. It's a long story which I don't have time to go through tonight, but this was the sequence of events that these experts explained to us, and they said very categorically that if we had the money and the mission to put humans in hibernation on a long distant flight throughout the solar system, it would in fact be feasible. So logical was it, and so much work that the Dr. Orman Mitchell at the New York Medical Center did on this, that he finally did a full-fledged scientific chapter in the academic press, Advances in Space Science and Technology series that I happened to edit at that time. Next, please. And some lighter things, we had to figure out what people were going to wear. We were in the midst of the miniskirt revolution, started in England right when we were there. And so Kubrick and texting one of us, but nobody thought we were wearing pants in those days. And they said, well, in the gravity field, namely in the Space Station 5, they would probably wear a dress or a suit of some sort. So the designers came up with a little hat and jacket, the skirt, the stockings, and the shoes, all the same color. Next, please. And in the gravity-free environment, such as in Ares 1B, they would wear this pantsuit of the head. These would protect the hair, keep the woman's hair protected, and would also protect against bumping in the ceiling or any wall. And we had Velcro slippers. Well, that's one thing we all missed, the fact that people would move around freely in zero gravity. We had them all in Velcro slippers as if they were walking
You have been traveling less than an hour and have remembered to call your office.
Its aerodynamic design will allow it to pass through the Earth.
pod-shaped vehicles of very light construction will be used for transportation. Roy Carden has visualized for Stanley Kubrick many of the unusual and striking sets for 2001. He has given form to scientific concepts of life on the moon in greater detail than any living artist. This complex is the shuttle base with a communication network in the background. This is the lunar shuttle with its access ramps and an observatory with its communication center. This is a segment of the moon's surface transport. Great technical detail has gone into the production of 2001, A Space Odyssey. Working from today's knowledge of the space age, the designers take us 35 years into the future. Scores of engineers and craftsmen work designing the sets and props, which combine existing knowledge with the projections of Arthur C. Clarke and Stanley Kubrick. On the drawing board, the designs are brought to life in the construction shops, from the smallest props to space vehicles. Finally, they are placed in the gaping storehouses of the MGM Property Department, where these strange new shapes will wait until called to play their parts. The story of 2001, A Space Odyssey, begins on the moon, then goes on to show the opening days of the exploration of our solar system. It explores man's place in the universe and his position in the order of cosmic intelligence. The art director of 2001, A Space Odyssey, is Tony Masters. For nearly 2 years, he has labored to bring the ideas and designs of artists and engineers into being. Here, he works on a model of the centrifuge, a vital section of the spacecraft in which important sequences of the film will be played. The centrifuge posed an unprecedented design and engineering challenge. And the challenge was met by Vickers Armstrong, one of Britain's largest aircraft manufacturers, who constructed this strange, intriguing centrifuge. Here is the completed centrifuge in motion. It is a 38-ton colossus. And its great complexity demands a drastically new approach to directing, lighting, and photography. To accomplish the effect of weightlessness, cameras are placed in radically unorthodox mounts. Optical engineers had to design equipment which would meet the requirements of Kubrick's bizarre and incisive imagination.
Clark and Tom Buck of Look Magazine.
Where
the girl on the web ship, and one can almost imagine we're on our way to the moon. We've arrived at the moon, as a matter of fact. Yes, it's hard to realize that in a few years, all our astronauts will be looking through this window at the lunar surface. And what we're doing in the movie, 2001, The Space Odyssey, is showing some of the things that will develop in the world of the future as a result of our present first steps into space.
Arthur, in one of your earlier books, you indicated that people are space conscious, but not space minded. What is the distinction?
So, you know, the exploration of the universe is much more than a contest between two mid-20th century powers. It's really the next stage in the evolution of mankind. I'm sure that the men who built the first boats and reeds and logs never imagined the ocean-going commerce of today or the great nations beyond the sea. And similarly, the men who started the conquest of the air only a lifetime ago couldn't have conceived of the great jets and now roaring through the skies. Well, what we're starting now with our ride into space is the next step in evolution. Out on the moon and planets are the new frontiers which our age needs so desperately. The next generation will explore the planets, bring back new knowledge, answering old questions, and of course, asking fresh ones. And after the explorers will come, as they always do, the colonists, reshaping our neighboring worlds with the tools of future science. About half a century ago, the great Russian space pioneer Tsiolkovsky said, "Earth is the cradle of mankind, but you cannot live in the cradle forever." And that is very true, and out here among the stars lies the destiny of mankind.
Back at MGM in Longwood, England, production on 2001 continues. International interest makes the publicity department a center where reports on the progress of 2001, The Space Odyssey, are circulated throughout the world.
Inside the giant centrifuge, the tech
technology of spaceflight is seen at close range.
Time. And then I said, no, that's That's all I did. So I went and I put on the leotard, and I put some towels in it to change the shape of my body. And I had a character called Joe that I used to play on stage. Joe was a pugnacious, mean son of a bitch. He didn't trust anybody. He was very paranoid. And he knew most people were smarter than him, but he wasn't going to let them get the upper hand on him just because of that, you see. So I told Joe, who I talked to inside my head, I told Joe, okay, Joe, I want you to pretend that you're a monkey and go out in front of these jokers. So I went out, and Stanley started talking, and I spun around and looked at him, like, what do you want, you know? And he said, that's pretty good, you know. So I went out and said, can you do any more? So I went back, and then I came back, and I had another little effete, little sort of very nervous little character that I used to play. See? So I came out like that, you know. And he said, wow. You know, so he sat down, we started talking, and I said, you know, that's the way, in my opinion, how you're going to have to solve this thing. You're going to have characters like the Seven Dwarfs, you know, recognizable characters with a lot of energy who just blow the screen away. And he said, well, that's great. And he offered me a job. And I said, well, I didn't come out here for a job. I don't want to do this. And he said, no. Why don't you think about it? And anyway, we're going to shoot this in 10 weeks in Almeria in Spain. And, you know, and I said, well, I don't think so. I think this is going to take you more like 6-8 months, something like that, to put this together. And I doubt whether you're going to shoot it on location. You're probably going to shoot it in the studio. And I think that's what really sold him. Because the idea of it getting more complicated and to, you know, that we had a chance to really do something with this appealed to him. So he made me an offer I couldn't refuse. And I came, and suddenly here was this furry sort of beatnik mime hippie. I come out there and I'm a choreographer to Stanley Kubrick, you know. I guess they have a sign on the door, Dan. I was fainting, you know. And I'm sitting there in this big empty office with a telephone, you know, and nothing, you know. And it turns out they expect me to sort of start doing all this stuff, put the whole thing together. And Arthur came by, gave me a script, and we got talking. And I spent the next year of my life with Stanley every day talking about everything from the Vietnam War, William Burroughs, the things we were working on, you know, Napoleon, and whatever, and our children. We ended up making this thing, but it did take us a little more than 8 months, actually, about 9 or 10 months before we did shoot it. I had to go through 40,000 people to cast the 28. It's true. But what happened was is that you may have heard in Jerry Angel's book, once I developed the choreography and the movement, I studied Jane Goodall, the I love footage from Jane Goodall. Fred met with Richard and Louis Leakey, and we wanted to reconstruct Australopithecines. And we realized that we could not make these costumes in less than 5 years because they were so complicated. Because we'd have to cast the people, then we'd have to make them. So what we did was Stuart Freeborn, Stuart said, well, you know, Mr. Kubrick, if you can give me sort of like a factory, and I can get all these people, I'll go to Madame Tussauds and all these places, I'll get every modeler and artist I can find, and if I know exactly what the costume is going to be before we have the people, I can get all these people working. So we designed, actually, what we did is, we made this, which shows this, the actual exact dimensions that Stuart would build costumes to. And then I began the process of casting to that, so that I would cast the people to the costumes rather than build the costumes. And what we did, we had open calls at the dance center in Covent Garden. We put these ads in the paper saying we need some, you know, people under 5'9", who weigh less than 135 pounds, blah, 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 blah. And then I'd have assistants put up rows of people, and everybody under the sun would turn up because they'd heard about this movie, and everybody knew this crazy American director was out in Boreham Wood making some super secret space crazy thing. And so we'd have all these people, and I would go down the line going, no, 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 yes, can you wait right here? No. And we went through, over a period of about 2 months, we went through an inordinate amount of people. We also got a list of every high school track athlete in England. All of the runners' clubs, because we thought long-distance runners were skinny, you know. We ended up with 20 people. And I can go on and on and on, but I've tried to put it all down, because what people do not realize is how much time. Everybody says it's such a great moment in pictures. Well, it was a great moment because an inordinate amount of work was put into it, and an inordinate amount of wonderful people worked on it. What I like to call the Stanley Kubrick University. We were all in our 20s or less. Some people were in their teens. And it was a time of great vision, a great excitement, and perhaps it was because of the vision of the space program, which had lit the world up. Because it was also the 60s in London, which was a phenomenal time. I mean, we'd shoot during the day, in the evening, go to parties with people. But anyway, I'm going to wrap up now because I'm monopolizing everything. But I want to just say that it's a real pleasure being here, and I love the fact that all you rocket scientists are science fiction fans.
Rocket ship in your palm. I that afternoon, and there was a message to call my agent in New York, and I called them, and they said, Stanley Kubrick has just offered you the lead in his next film, which is a science fiction film. That really happened. And now we jump to several months later, I arrive in London, and I'm staying up in a little cottage they arranged for me to live in North London. And wake up the next, my first morning in London, and the phone rings. And I pick up the phone, and I hear the voice say, may I speak to Keir Dullea? And I said, this is he. And the gentleman said in a very young sounding voice, he said, oh, gee, gosh, this is Stanley. And that was my introduction to Stanley Kubrick. And it's really hard to capitalize the amazing experience that it was to make this film. I certainly, not just now looking back, but at that time, felt extraordinarily privileged to be working with a man who already was recognized as a world-class director. When I was in drama school, I had an afternoon off and I went to see a Kirk Douglas film. It was a war film. And I walked in and it blew me out of my seat. It was Paths of Glory. I'd never heard of Stanley Kubrick, and little did I know then, as a young drama student, that I would someday be working with this genius. Stanley, you know, there are a lot of rumors about him being a recluse and so on. He wasn't a recluse. It's just he had only so much energy, and his energy either went into his work, or which was most of the time, or into his family. He was a real family man, and he had no time or inclination to socialize. I think I remember his driver told me that he, in a year's time, had only taken Stanley to a restaurant once. For Stanley, to paraphrase Shakespeare, the film was the thing. And that's true. He was, it's hard to describe him because he was such a multidimensional character. I was describe him as being like an onion. Every layer you peel off are two more waiting for you to peel off. He was a quiet man with a lovely, quiet sense of humor. And he had an eye for detail that was unbelievable. I mean, there was no detail that was too small for him to take the time and attention. I mean, I remember the first day that we arrived on the set was to, we didn't shoot because he didn't like the way these Velcro shoes looked. I mean, you don't really notice people's feet in film too often, but he wouldn't shoot that day because they weren't right. And all told, working with Stanley was wonderful. And, you know, he would get people that there was something he had a quiet, commanding sense. And he never ordered you to do anything. He allowed you to come up with ideas. I think often they were his ideas, but he gave you the feeling they were yours. I remember I was a little in awe of Stanley when I arrived. I couldn't relax, and he took me aside after the end of the first week in shooting and just started talking to me about how much he'd liked my work and why he'd chosen me and how he was feeling badly that he wasn't giving me what I needed. So he was, and I was tense. I was a little tense because I couldn't get this awe off out of the way, which I did very quickly, and he helped me do. Incidentally, talking about how he chose me, he actually screened two films I had done. One was a film which I received the Golden Globe for, David and Lisa, and the other was The Thin Red Line. Thank you. He screened The Thin Red Line, which is the first version of that film, and then also outtakes from the filming process, the one I was making with Laurence Olivier. I mentioned that Stanley would get you to do things you probably wouldn't do for any other director. He would insist he used a stuntman, and not that anything we did was near as risky as what the real astronauts did. But I will describe one stunt that was quite something. The scene where my blown into the emergency airlock. How that was done was, the set was actually built perpendicular, so that it was actually built that way. And it was a very tall set. Of course, it was supposed to look as a lateral set going toward you or going toward the camera. Camera being subjective doesn't know what direction it's looking in, so it was actually built that way. And they had the front of the pod just showing when the doors would slide open to the emergency lock. And then I was supposed to hurtle inward. How that was done was it had a false front, and then I was waiting on a platform which was built vertically next to the set. And I was attached, I had a piano wire, it was a very strong, tiny cable that was attached, if you'll excuse the expression, to the crotch area so that my body be between the cable and the camera and you wouldn't see it. And then that in turn was in some way woven to a long rope, which was knotted in several places. And they had a circus roustabout standing next to me with heavily gloved hands. So what I had to do was dive head first, free fall, toward the camera. They figured out how long the rope needed to be before I would crash into the camera. And that was where the knot was made. So the circus guy let the rope whip through his hands until he reached knot and then clinched it, which saved my life. Then he would instantaneously jump off that platform, so it was a hook and tackle effect. So he would hurtle toward the ground, and I went hurtling back up to the ceiling again. It was like a Laurel and Hardy comedy. And then as soon as his feet hit the floor, he let go of the rope again, and I went hurtling back again toward it. So he had, of course, this was the whole, you know, as if I was hurtling toward you. So that's how that was done. Another scene which I'll describe, which might interest you, in terms of how it was done, was also involved a question that one of you wrote down in one of these sheets. So rather than answer the question when we get to that question period, which comes up a little later in the evening, I will answer it now. How that was, if you remember, this is the scene where I came in through the hub, and all in one shot with no cutaway and no split screen. I came. I came down the ladder, and in that shot, as I came down from the hub, you could see Gary Lockwood upside down on the opposite end of the centrifuge eating. And I came down to the floor of the centrifuge and walked upside down to him, all in one shot with no cutaway. How that was done was, he actually had a harness under his costume, and he was sitting upside down. And they had to paste the pieces of food so they wouldn't drop toward camera. And so I was like a rat in a treadmill. I came down from the hub and just stood in place. And they revolved Gary down to me. But it looked like I was walking up to him. And that's how that was done. I'm trying to remember any other. I think those are two key experiences that I had that... will illuminate some of the things that we had to do in the film. It was nothing that prepared me, however, for seeing the film, because you can't see the forest for the trees. This very subjective experience, and so much was added later on. So I think that the film blew me away as much as it did anybody else seeing it for the first time. Before I finish, I would just like to say to you all something I told Dan Richter, because we only met recently. That the Dog Man sequence was done long after I had gone, and perhaps because it was the part of the film that I was had least expectation about. That is the Dog Man sequence. I knew I'd seen some of the sets of the central part of the film, the part dealing with the. With Floyd and the discovery of the monolith on the surface of the moon. I'd seen some of those sets, even though I hadn't started shooting yet. And of course, my section of the film was very somewhat familiar with the look of it, although I had no idea what it would be like with these special effects. Incidentally, just want to remind you all what a genius Stanley was. He invented all of the concepts. Other people rendered them. But he basically thought of so many of the concepts that were used. And this was before computer computer-generated special effects. None of the special effects were generated. These were all done mechanically, one way or the other. And just to get back to what I was saying about Dan's part of the film, is that my personal favorite moment in the whole film is what I call the missing link moment, and that is the moment when the ape that he played, the ape man, is kind of aimlessly playing with some bones. That's just after he's touched the monolith the day before. The night happens, and then we see the effect. And he's aimlessly playing with some bones, and in the slightest, subtlest moment, you got the moment when the penny dropped, and it became purposeful. And I think that's one of the magical moments for me in the film. And having said that, I'm going to turn it back over to Fred. Thank you.
But I met with him,
I remember I had my camera, which I had with me on a visit to Vietnam. I had just been to Vietnam for the Air Force, and it was another exciting experience of mine, the sort of things that live in my memory very, very clearly etched in every detail, as was this meeting with Stanley. And he picked up my camera. Now, I understood, and I'm sure this is true, he was a photographer, I guess McCall was, in his younger days, and a skilled one, I'm sure. But he was kind of interested in my camera. It was a Nikon that I had used, and it was battered, and it showed a lot of use. And he made a comment about that, which, again, I vividly remember. He invited me to get my family, bring them over, and spend 3 or 4 months working on paintings that would then be used to exploit and advertise the film. Well, this is an opportunity that just thrilled me no end. And he said, don't worry about an apartment, we'll take care of that. Don't worry about anything. Just do it, if you possibly can and if you want to. And of course I did. I called my wife, Louise, who's by the way right here, as is Catherine, my daughter, both of whom then joined me in London, and we spent 4 incredible months. I worked Wormwood. Stanley sent a limo for me. It wasn't really a limo, but it was a nice automobile and a driver. Every morning, took me home every evening. The trip was about a 40-minute drive to Wormwood from the heart of London, right next to Buckingham Palace. We were living, really living it up, and enjoying every minute of it. We took Catherine out of school. She, I think, profited from the experience. It was 4 months of intense concentration, but just filled with a lot of great joy and pleasure in creating these images. I created dozens and dozens of sketches, and I kept sketchbooks, many pages of drawings, which then I would show to Stanley. He would look through them. I would recommend that we do one or two of these into a major painting, 4 by 6 feet, I think, was the size of all 4 of those images, 3 of which were used extensively. 1 was not used so much, but all were quite successful. But it's curious how one image somehow captures the spirit of an event or a message, and that was the one of the space station, and out of the hub was coming the Pan Am shuttle. I photographed these sets, and all the sets were so fantastic. The big centrifuge had already been dismantled. I never did see that. This was in 67, and you were there. I think you were long gone, perhaps. And I saw you, Dan, but you didn't see me. But I was in that, you know, cage that they use when the leopard jumps over the cliff. I was there, and I watched some of that filming. Cooper called me from my little studio that was set up at Wormwood for me to paint. And he said, Bob, you might be interested in seeing this shooting. And I indeed was. And I eagerly went over, and I watched this. And in the cage, to protect the cinematographer and Stanley himself, and in this case, me as well, from the leopard, which was a wild animal, from maybe running wild, I watched the sequence where the leopard jumps down and attacks the ape men. How do you call it? Were the ape men, or what? You don't use that term. Man apes. Well, that's good. I like that. Anyway, and then I watched you guys, Dan and the other man apes, and it was explained to me how they made the masks and how the lips articulated, and it was just a marvelous thing. Well, to say the least, the whole experience was one that I'll never forget. I remember we went to a party at Stanley's home, a very small one. There were eight of us there. And we had a great conversation. Stanley was about an hour late in joining us at dinner. Christiana, his wife, was there. I guess the daughter or the kids, did he have 2 or 1? 2, 3, were elsewhere in the house. Yeah, and But they were wonderful hosts, and when Stanley arrived in his leather jacket, having worked till about 9 o'clock, we had a meal and stimulating conversation. And one of the expressions, one of the things that he said after talking to Louise, my wife, and I'll never forget it, nor will she, he said, "She's the most intelligent woman I've ever talked to." Now, how about that? Now, we know that can't be true, but maybe it is. Well, I don't know. I guess it was. I should have said, of course it was true. It had to be. But she is an intelligent woman, let me tell you. But in any event, Catherine was at that party as well. We went to a couple of other social occasions while we were there with Stanley. Chris John is a brilliant artist. We have one of her recent books. She paints florals, a still life, and other subjects. And very, very beautiful and with a brilliant talent. And my wife is also a painter of still life, and she has a brilliant talent as well. I want to close my comments with something that I wrote down in the hotel room about 2 hours ago. And it goes this way. I'm going to read it. And then I have just a few pictures to show you. One of the most compelling questions driving the human spirit is, where did we come from? Where are we going? It underlies our insatiable desire for more of everything, more knowledge, more understanding, more comprehension. We are living in a time of enormous change, in the midst of a revolution of awesome scale, unlike any in human history. Exploding all around us. The thrill of the unknown and the unknowable universe and the wonder of it. It's of which we are a tiny part, and indeed a very tiny part, because we are learning every day how enormous the universe is. We'll never understand it totally. Each year, each month, indeed, at the pace at which we are going, with this unraveling of the knowledge of the universe, we are peeling back veils that reveal new information, which only reveal more mysteries. And that's the fascination of it. And you people are imbued with that fascination and that wonder. And isn't it wonderful to be part of this glorious universe? Thank you. Very much. Now I'm going to go over here. I've just got, I think, 10 slides to show you. I'm going to go through them rapidly. Okay, I've got to be able to see these. And this is the first one. Of course, this is so familiar, I even questioned whether I should put it on the screen. We don't need this. We've seen it many, many times. But to me, it's a very important image, as you might guess. Next, please. This is Bob McCall emerging from the Bournemouth soundstage with a new painting that I had just finished, and I'm carrying it out, and I'm going to meet Stanley at the edge of the area. And notice I have a beard. And why did I have that beard? Because it seemed to me Stanley had one, and not only that, that was good reason enough, but everybody else grew a beard. And I guess it was conforming to what the boss had at night. And when I returned home, Catherine said, "Daddy, you look so old." I immediately got rid of that one. Next slide, please. This is the painting of which some of you will recognize. It's an oil painting on masonite. It's 4 by 6 feet, and that's Stanley. And this is moments after that previous
photograph was shown. Next, please. Now, this is a picture that was taken by Stanley, and that's me in the picture, and on the extreme left is Louise, and in the darkened area, and I guess you can't even see her, but that's Catherine, who is with us tonight. There are other people there. I don't remember who that pretty girl is on the right. The one on the left, I already told you, was my wife. And the figure in the foreground is Chris John. Next slide, please. Oh, this is one. Now, Kira, can you get around and see this? Where are you? Remember you said you couldn't quite remember that particular poster and that particular picture of yourself. Well, that's you. No, it isn't. Well, that doesn't matter. Next slide, please. Now, this is a little closer view of it, and you can see that that looks, I think it looks like you. That's you. That's just a close-up of that same image. I spent hours and hours going through every slide and every 4x5 transparency, and there were thousands of them in Stanley's office at Warren Wood, and he allowed me to come in there and just spend hours going through the stills that had been taken as the production progressed. Next, please. And I used these images, of course. This is just another image of that shovel. And now another painting. Next, please, is a painting that I made for the Disney Studios of a futuristic space shuttle docking at a space station of the distant future. The future is so filled with mystery and unknowns, of course, totally unknown. But it promises to be a wonderful one. Next, please. This is a rocket plane that I did for the New York Times Magazine about 2 years ago. And the blue line at the top suggests that this is a rocket ship that will fly in a very low Earth orbit, and the trip from Kennedy to Beijing would be 1 hour. And this is in the offing. These things are going to happen, just as surely as we're going to send men to Mars. It will happen, inevitably. This is a painting that I did for the Dryden Flight Research Center, and it's a detail of just the center section of that large painting. But there again, in the heavens above, you see a hypersonic transport aircraft, which is in our future. Next, please. And this is my last slide, and it was part of a small sketch that I made for a mural that I did for the Ames Research Facilities. The NASA research facility, and I think it captures my feeling about the exuberant spirit of man reaching for the stars. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Do you read me? Open the pod bay doors now.
I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that.
I first saw the movie 2001 when it premiered in Houston, Texas. I had hopes, very high hopes, that some years later I would travel into space. And so I looked quite closely at what at least the movie makers thought space was going to be like and came away with a very definite impression.
The people who enjoyed 2001 when it was first released in the 60s had sort of grown up with a different kind of science fiction. Arthur Clarke was probably the best known of all the science fiction writers of that generation.
I was surprised and or delighted by the impact of 2001. I was even surprised when I saw it myself for the first time because we didn't know exactly how it would end.
Perhaps you couldn't clear up the great mystery about what has been going on up there.
The people who made 2001, not just the writer and Stanley Kubrick, but the people whom they hired to get the technical details right, really worked at it.
Stanley Kubrick, you know, gave us, you know, I can't say carte blanche. He was a tough man to work for, believe me, very, very tough. But he said, Fred, give me the best technical and scientific information that you can based on a screenplay. And so everything that you saw in the film, every vehicle, every sensor, every instrumentation panel, everything had to go through my review. The food dispensing scenes all came out of the contacts we've made with the Whirlpool Corporation. Very logical. I don't know about how you might dispense food in the year 2001, but I knew the people who might. Spacesuits, we went to England to the Frankenstein group, the Victoria Rubber Works, who had built the aviation suits for high altitude pilots at the time.
The spacesuits worn in the movie are very close to spacesuits, even indeed like the Apollo spacesuits behind us here. The food that to my eyes looked in the movie like one could get in the frozen food section of a supermarket, very like to the food that's served on space stations right now, very similar.
We felt that by the year 2001, the space industry would, to a large extent, be a private in the private domain. That's why on Space Station 5, for example, we had Hilton Hotel, Howard Johnson Restaurants, Bell Telephone Systems.
Hello. I just work.
Those touches really do, I think, ground the moviegoer and help make it seem real. The instructions for use of the tablet, for example, people just people at that and make an immediate real world connection to it. I think that was a really key element in the film.
Albert was one of the world's great director for his attention to detail. He just wanted to make certain that everything was absolutely perfect. And we never knew where he was going to poke his camera. That's the other thing. Everything you see in this film, every image is realistic. And you say, why? Because we didn't know where he was going to poke his camera. And we wanted to cover ourselves. My main disagreement with Stanley Kubrick was the fact that we had filmed and developed some excellent, I felt, narration that would explain a little bit what was happening between major sequences of the film. And all of that narration was stopped.
The climax of the film is impossible to really understand. I think everyone interprets it in their own way, but I've also always thought that's sort of the point.
Well, Stanley Kubrick, of course, was responsible for all the details of the film. I don't think he really intended to confuse, just more to make people think, extend their imaginations. One of my favorite 2001 stories. Landed in Hawaii, soon after the film was released, the immigration officer looked at my passport and he said, I won't let you in till you explain the ending of the movie.
The feeling that space is an open frontier and humans sooner or later are going to exploit it and penetrated and become a space-faring civilization.
2001, like 1984, George Orwell. 2001 is the perfect moment to stop and look at it again. I think 2001 connects to all of those mythic elements that you see in great tales.
To my mind, I think the message is we humans are a curious creature. And we have, as part of our inherent makeup, the curiosity about who are we, how do we get here, are we alone, and that we will continue to search for answers to those questions. And at such time we stop searching, I believe that we cease to be humans.
The future is now. Get back on
that, please.
FAQs, frequently asked questions about 2001, the communists. disappointed with what's happened? The answer is yes and no. We haven't got lots of people in space. We haven't got the kilometer. We haven't got Pan Am. We certainly haven't got a base on the moon. And we're not planning human trips to Jupiter for a while, or indeed even to Mars. On the other hand, we've seen so much that I never imagined I would see in my lifetime. The reconnaissance, the preliminary reconnaissance, admittedly by rover probes, of all the solar system except Pluto. And I think Pluto is on the menu before long. So, on the whole, I'm very happy about what has happened. Now, looking into the possible future, and I don't claim to predict this, because these are my hunches, my feelings, the things that may happen. Obviously, our existing propulsion systems must be improved and developed. And I congratulate people like Buzz Aldrin, who was here recently, on their attempts to get space tourism underway. That may be one of the ways of paying for the exploration of the near environment. I believe that we already have one space tourist who's put up a few tens of millions, call it tens of millions. But space travel on anything more than experimental or a scientific scale, I hope not on a military scale, can't do very much until we have far cheaper ways of exploring or entering space. Well, as many of you know, I've been keen on the space elevator, the cable from Earth's equator, preferably here in Sri Lanka, as I described in the transit cars, up to the geostationary orbit. And as it happens, we now have the material to make that possible, carbon-60. If carbon-60 can be manufactured in large quantities, and remember, it's hundreds of times stronger than any metal, the building of the space elevator will be a simple engineering problem, but of course it will cost a lot. Why should we build it? What are we going to? Because it only takes us to the stationary orbit, but it means it's up to there. The cost of space travel is essentially zero, because you recover all your energy on the way back. Gravity does the work. You do the work on the way up, gravity does it on the way down. Beyond that, I seriously think that some kind of space drive, beloved by us crazy science fiction writers, may emerge, but who knows when. It's my feeling that the rocket is going to do to space travel just what the balloon did to aviation. At the moment, my great interest is in Mars, and as you know, the Mars Odyssey, which I'm very glad I'm named after a little home movie of mine, is on its way successfully, I hope, to Mars, and I hope it lands and everything goes fine. It's my feeling that already there's a lot of life on Mars. I don't know if you've seen the recent images. Some seem to me, I think, it's a show running. That was the large areas of vegetation or its equivalent. Finally, I must say I'm rather upset by reports of a recent television program claiming or attempting to claim that the whole moon landing was a fake. Some of them have said that I had written the script. a joke in rather poor taste. In fact, if the EOM article around, I would suggest it was a communist plot. Discredit the achievement for which the United States will be best remembered 1,000 years from now. I don't know if anybody is seriously taking this to be true, the idea of a hoax. I can't imagine anybody would be stupid enough to imagine an enterprise involving perhaps 250,000 people over a decade and several administrations could have been faked. I think it was Ben Franklin, it usually is, who once said, a secret known to three people can only be kept if two of them are dead. I'm not speaking about the space hoax. Anyway, I'm very glad to have spoken to you, and I wish you the best of luck. And I hope some of you will be going into space very, very
first one. The question was, who made the decision to name Hal for IBM? Well, Hal was named by Stanley Kubrick and Arthur Clarke following a suggestion following a suggestion from Marvin Minsky of the Artificial Intelligence Laboratory at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. Heuristic algorithm, heuristic AL algorithm. That was the name. The idea that it would be related by moving one letter forward, become IBM, was something none of us, and I guarantee that none of us even thought about back in the 1960s. The second question, group of questions, one of them, Keir Dullea has already answered. Bob, do any of you, how do any of you, your thoughts of what human race for the future, it's not quite clear to me, what do you think the future of space exploration is going to be for the human race? It's a little gone here, but that's the question.
I think it's going to affect us all profoundly, and that it will affect us in a very positive way. I've always been an optimist. There are negatives associated with every great scientific breakthrough, with the explorations. We're going to Mars, I mentioned that earlier, but I have such a conviction of it, and I was pleased to hear Arthur in that message express pretty much the same kind of feeling. But it's, if you can imagine, I am convinced that there will be literally hundreds of people engaged in orbital space, either actively out there as explorers, engineers, not just explorers, by the way, they'll be following a life. Their life will be involved in orbital space. And then in deeper space, sometime we're going to establish a colony on Moon, without a doubt. You know, the only thing about this is that we don't know the time frame. We can't be sure of it. But things change, and they change rapidly, so that perhaps in another 5 years or 10 years, there will be an imperative on the part of the American people or people around the world, because we're not the only spacefarers, and we will not remain the leading spacefarers as we are today forever. All things change, but I'm very optimistic, and it's going to be a wonderful time. I just wish, well, so many of you will be alive, and I'll be alive for part of it, but it would be great to be here for the next century. Thank you.
Here, as Captain Bowman, how would you feel about living on the moon or on Mars?
Well, I don't know about living there, but I certainly, how would I like to live there? That's very hard to project. I mean, I love my life right here on planet Earth. If you would ask me about visiting, I would give you a whole different answer, but I like it right where I am. You know, can I get 30 seconds about something I meant to share with this audience, which I totally forgot? I'll shorten it. Stanley was not able to decide on the voice. He had certain actors he worked with, but he, for the voice of Hal, so he decided to wait until post-production. Therefore, the voice that I had to work with was the assistant director, and the assistant director sounded something like this. Dive. You had to take a stress pill, Dive. Yeah, it was all like this. It sounded a little like Marco Kane.
Getting to final Hal was quite a job, which we don't have time to go into that yet because it was quite fascinating. Dan, how would any of you, we're talking to you specifically in this field, about exploring other planets of our solar system in the Milky Way or in intergalactic space?
Oh, I'm ready.
You're ready.
Yeah, absolutely. I just would like you, there's a couple people I'd like to take with me. I mean, I,
certainly love to have Stanley along, and I'd love to have Arthur along. I mean, and actually, I'd like to have everybody in this room come with me.
Okay, the final question, and I've got to keep my clock, I have 1 minute left. This is to the audience. To all the guests, did you ever believe that the movie you were producing or you were seeing would have an impact on your lives here in the year, the real year, 2001? Anybody want to put a hand on that? Right here? Yes, sir?
The history of humanity has been that of exploration. When we stop asking questions, when we stop looking at what is on or over the horizon, we die as a race. The visions that Kubrick, here, Watcher, and all that you produce have forever placed within my mind the desire to always learn, to continue learning. And I think that that is something that we must bring to all of our contemporaries, to our children, to our nation, to the world. When we stop asking questions, we die. So long as we ask those questions, we live forever.
Thank you very, very much. It's now 10 o'clock. I was given orders to end this program at 10 o'clock, otherwise I don't get my bonus. Thank you very, very much for being with us tonight. We have about 15 minutes to clear the room, and they're going to set up to show the full film, 2001 Space Odyssey. Thank you very much.